My name's Brian Jenkins. Pastor Stan said, I'm the teaching and theology pastor for New Life Church. We're in South King County. You've met and heard from Pastor Troy before. I've been on staff there for coming up on 4 years. And as much as it sounds like New Life has had some influence here, just know Horizon has had a huge influence on New Life as well, particularly when it comes to kingdom builders. We've been able to do some amazing things in our region, and because of really Pastor Stan helping Pastor Troy understand. Pastor Stan came and spoke for us and helped us cast vision for kingdom builders last year. So it's really been a very cool relationship to see our two churches sort of doing what we can in the Pacific Northwest. Part of kind of our exchange this morning, part of our understanding of each other is knowing a little bit about me. So one thing that's important to know about me is that I did not come into the world as this sort of well put together, obviously distinguished person that stands before you today. I've never been called a dessert, although I have been a tasty snack. Who knows, right? Am I right? No? Okay, just kidding. Neither of those have ever been spoken over me. A bitter pill, maybe I've been that, but that would be it, no. But my family's originally from Arkansas. My parents are from a small town in southern Arkansas called Crossett, Arkansas. My mom is from the metro of Crossett. My dad is from a small suburb of Crossett called Cooter. That is a real place that actually exists, and my father is from there. So we did not grow up in my life with like fancy things. Now, my dad was in the military. My dad was in the Air Force. He did very well for himself. So we are often surrounded, and he was an officer. So we are often surrounded by people that were used to, you know, sort of nice, fine things. But we are always just kind of like in the background saying, if they ever knew how really like white trash we are, they like we put the cracker in Cracker Barrel. Like that's kind of who I am, where I'm from, right? So I remember when all my friends started getting cars, and you know, I was in Arkansas, they'd always get like these really nice trucks, or these really nice cars. A big thing when I was in high school was like the Volkswagen Rabbits with the convertible tops. So I'm like, oh, what's my car gonna be? Right? What kind of car am I gonna get? So dad was like, hey, I got you a car. And I'm like, oh my gosh, you got me a car. So I walk outside and the car that I get is a 1970 Volvo sedan, right? 1970 Volvo sedan, not a station wagon, a sedan. Now, let me stop you right there because some of you may think, oh, an old vintage Volvo, that must be cool. Like maybe you've been in Portland or you've seen them driving around, like, oh, the hipsters with their great beards, right? And their craft, whatever, and you know, their succulents and their white shiplath, and they're driving around in their vintage Volvos, right? That's not this car. Please get that out of your mind completely. So my 1970 Volvo, the Volvo that was really my first car, my 1970 Volvo, you say, okay, well, what was it like? Well, let me tell you about the color. The color of my 1970 Volvo. The color of my 1970 Volvo was, it had no paint at all. My color was primer. So whatever color that is, the paint at some point had just been shorn. I don't know cars. But it had just been like ground off. So it had no paint on it. It was no color. So that was my 1970 Volvo. A few other things about my 1970 Volvo. It didn't have an FM radio with like a, this is a very old sentence, but like a cassette or a CD player. It had an in-dash mono speaker AM radio. That was it. And it was behind. Instead of having the handles on the side, there was one handle in the front, which I don't know what that was going to prevent other than ensuring that in the wreck, your shoulders would be dislocated also. That's all that was. My 1970 Volvo didn't have a speedometer that went like this with a dial. It was all the numbers, like all the miles per hour in a straight line in this little orange strip that would lead up to it, that would sort of suggest what time, what you know, your rate of speed. It would just sort of say, you're probably going 35, somewhere between there. That was my 1970 Volvo. My 1970 Volvo didn't have fuel injection. It had a choke. Anybody know what a choke is? So here I am, an 18-year-old kid, barely knowing how a car works, and somehow I have to figure out the exact mixture of gas and air to go into the pistons. And I'm over there doing this, hoping it'll work. My 1970 Volvo, the seat belts didn't like click back. They didn't ratchet in. You had to sit down, plug in it, and just strap yourself in like a NASCAR driver, hoping that it would work. Now, my 1970 Volvo, as much as I loved it and much as great as it was, on the passenger side was very interesting because the latch that would recline the seat was broken. So if you stepped on the gas quick enough, the person would just jerk back. And in my 1970 Volvo, when they jerked back and they looked over and they looked in the floor behind the driver's seat, they would see what? They would see the ground as we were driving over it because there was a huge hole in the bottom of my car. And the radio, as fun as it was a different issue because at some point the antenna had come off on my 1970 Volvo. And whoever replaced it with a CB antenna that was like 80 feet high. So while I couldn't get any FM stations, I could get AM stations from Pakistan. I was hearing stuff from Mars. That was it. And like the numbers code, like the CIA, like I was picking all of that kind of stuff up. But it wasn't a problem until I went through a drive-thru. And I'd go through a drive-thru and everyone would know because you'd hear it and it'd grab that little no height must not exceed thing. And we'd just hear it go, yes, I'll have a number 3, no onions, Diet Coke. And it would ratchet back. My 1970 Volvo, I don't know how fast it could go. I only reached 60 miles once, and it was because I was going downhill, and there was a tailwind. Like I felt like Fred Flintstone. I would just run, and my legs would hit it. So in all respects, that car was an absolute piece of junk. It was. It was janky, it was a hoopty, like whatever word you have for a junky car, that was my car. But here's the thing, it was my car. And because it was my car, I thought it was the best car in the world. I remember the horn on it was just, it was a handle. It wasn't like a thing in the middle. It was a handle you would grab and squeeze. So I was just honking at everybody all the time. But I loved that car. That car was me. That car was it. I loved driving my friends around in my car. My friends didn't like riding in the car, but I loved it because I was the only safe one. But that's fine. But the car, although worthless, although damaged, I don't know how much my dad paid for that car. In fact, I think someone paid my dad to take that car. You know, they pulled it out of some swamp somewhere. This is Arkansas. Probably got some raccoons out of it and said, here's your car, son. But as damaged as it was, as flawed as it was, as broken as it was mine. And because it was mine, it was valuable. Because it belonged to me. And I wonder how many of us here or at a campus this morning, we struggle when we think of things like God values me because we don't know that we belong to anybody. We don't know that anybody wants us. We don't know that anybody would have us. We come here, you're at Horizon, it's a beautiful day, a little windy, you guys need to do something about that. But beyond that, it's a great day and people are coming in and they're saying, welcome home. And they're saying, this is Horizon where everybody is somebody and Jesus is all. And you're like, that's great for you. But when I come into church, all I'm thinking is if they only knew. All I'm thinking when I come into church, Brian, you seem great. You seem all put together. You got, you know, it looks like your daughter picked out a very good outfit, like good for you. But when I come into church, all I'm thinking of is you may see me on Sunday morning, but if you only knew who I was last night, if you only knew what has happened to me, if you only know the things I've said, you wouldn't say that I'm valuable. You wouldn't say that I matter. You wouldn't say that I belong here. And Paul, in his letter to the Roman church, wants to speak about this. Because Paul, and as we're in this series for everyone, as Paul is in this letter, he's writing to this group of people that had a problem believing that everyone belonged there. See, in the ancient Roman church, there were all sorts of tensions, similar to some of the tensions that we feel in society today. There were racial tensions. There were economic tensions. There were tensions that came as a distinction of education. There were tensions of who is the outsider and who is the insider, who really belongs here. And so near the end of his life and near the end of his ministry, Paul steps up and he writes these words in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. He says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, and I'll tell you why. Because it's the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. Now we read that and we're like, oh, that's cool, but that was radical. Because the people that Paul was talking to said, no, it's their fault. No, it's their fault. We belong here and they don't. And Paul says, no, everyone belongs here. Everyone belongs here because the gospel, this idea that God made it, we broke it, and Jesus fixes it, that truth is for anyone, and it is for everyone. And so there's kind of two different ways of looking at this in the church today. There's one that says it doesn't belong to me, and there's some of us that struggle with it doesn't belong to them. And we see people in our society, we see people in our culture, and we don't think that they deserve it. And Paul says, no, 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 no. The gospel is for everyone. It has value. These people have value. Why? Because God values them. Look at what he says in Romans chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. He says, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God made it plain to them. Since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, his divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what was made. I want you to think about that. If you have a Bible, you can highlight it. If you're on the app, you can do whatever it is you do on an app. I don't know. I'm very old and I use a Bible, but there are app things you can do, I'm certain. But that idea of what has been made so that people are without an excuse. See, there's a question that we fundamentally ask, no matter who you are. And you may say, look, Brian, I just came to church because I lost a bet. I really have no idea why I'm here. Like my buddy said, yeah, I'll take you to the airport. We just have to stop someplace first. Welcome to Horizon, right? You're like, yeah, sure, we'll go to brunch. I just need to meet with some friends real quick. Come to my book study. Like, I don't know, you may have been tricked to being here, and you may have thought, I can't go there, man. If I go in, the walls are gonna come down. There's gonna be like lightning, all that brimstone stuff. If they only knew. You say, do I value, do I matter? These are all the questions that we ask. These are the fundamental questions of the human condition. Why on earth am I here? And so we push back when someone says something like, this is a church where everybody is somebody and Jesus is all. And you say, yeah, for you, because look, you've got it all together. Everyone's dressed so nice and the people sang those songs so well and that bit where the words came up. And this is like the best karaoke I've ever been to. I mean, the words are on the screen. You can sing along. It's awesome. And then people raised their hands, and I don't know, no one answered their question, but they all seemed very enthusiastic about it, right? But then someone gets up and says, you're welcome. You say, well, not me. We're excited you're here. Probably not. Because we struggle with these ideas. We think things like, I don't deserve the gospel. We think I don't need the gospel. I'm fine. We think I can do this myself. I can fix, I can move forward into eternity on my own. The gospel isn't for me, but Paul wants his readers to understand, no, 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 friends. It is for everyone. And the reason it's for everyone is because God made everyone. See, we struggle with the gospel because we don't think we matter to God. I would imagine any of you, whether you are, you know, you've been saved for a while, you've been a part of the church for a while, like I said, maybe this is your first Sunday and you're just exploring things. And I would imagine your reservations about faith probably don't have too much with actually believing in God. It's whether or not I believe God wants me. It's do I belong here? It's I come in and I ask the question, if they only knew, if they only saw, I don't belong here. And so why would I accept a truth that's not meant for me? How could I believe this thing that's not meant for me? How could I accept a gospel? You expect me to bow my knee to Jesus, to bow my heart to Jesus, to ask Jesus into my life, to get saved, like whatever language you want to put. But I have to start with the fact that I need the gospel. I don't think the gospel for me. I don't think I'm valuable enough. Why would God want me? And now you're telling me he wants me like forever. I don't even like being alone with me for 20 minutes. And you're saying God wants to dwell with me forever. What about my sin? What about my shame? What about my doubt? What about my fear? What about my brokenness? What about my rage, my addictions, my anger, my broken, abused heart? Like, look at me, I'm a mess. And we can all think of the reasons why God wouldn't want us. And so Paul steps in and he says, no, 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 no. I know we all have reasons why God doesn't want you. Let me give you the reasons why he does. His own story was full of religious pride and deep shame. And he knew that there were people who denied the gospel not only for themselves, but they also denied it for others. And so at the foundation of his theology, he says, I don't have to be embarrassed of what I believe. He says, I'm not ashamed. Another way of looking at that from a sort of that phrase, I'm not ashamed, as a Greek thought concept is, this truth has never let me down. Like, I don't have to be embarrassed of it. I don't have to be concerned about it. I have never been let down by this truth that the gospel is the power of God that brings salvation to who? To everyone. And it's a radical notion. Because he's still dealing with people that said, look, if you want to become a Christian, you have to become Jewish first, because the only real followers of God are Jewish. And people would be like, that's great. And then they get to the circumcision part and they'd be like, I'm out. No, thank you. And so Paul is trying to get them to understand this thing that I'm about to say, this idea that God made it, we broke it, that Jesus fixes it, it is for you. And the reason it's for you, the gospel's for everyone, because God made everyone. Because you exist, and that's what I want you to walk away with today. Above all things, if you hear me say anything, if you laugh, if you cry, if you say, is he going to keep like saying things to himself, expecting we understand what's going on, like all, whatever happens there, that you would say, the gospel's for me because God made me. Just the fact that I'm here, the fact that you exist means that you matter to God. Because everybody is somebody, and Jesus is all. And everyone, no matter how flawed, nor how broken, whether you just have primer, whether your antenna's broken, whether there's holes in your soul, like whatever it is, your brain don't work right, your body don't, like whatever it is, your heart's broken, your mess, like you could be the biggest dumpster fire in the world, but we will see you as a dumpster fire that is on fire for Jesus. It may be a dumpster, but at least it's on fire. Like, let's do that. Because when God looks at you, God sees something he made, and you may not have value to even yourself, but you have value to him. And therefore, he wants to hang out with you forever. And we say, well, what is that? How does that work? He says, I made it plain. He says, it's been in there from the beginning. God's invisible qualities, his eternal nature, his divine power, those sorts of things in Romans 19 and 20, have been clearly seen, being understood from what was made. In other words, Paul is saying, and he's speaking to the Gentiles now because he's not speaking to the Jews. The Jews had the word, they had revelation. All the Gentiles had was nature. All the Gentiles had were the rivers and the streams and the creeks and the mountains. And so what happened is he said, God was telling you too that he's out there. That creation speaks of who he is. And so discovering value, discovering purpose starts with discovering the creator. My daughter in high school made this thing that I believe was intended to be a pen holder. I actually don't know what it is, but she brought it to me and I love it. And I'm the only one who loves it, but I don't love it because it's great. I love it because it's hers. I have no idea what it is. I put pens and pencils in it. I think that's all it's good for. But it sits in my office, and there it is. And I can say that my daughter made this. And everyone goes, that's something. But it has value to me because of who made it. So you have value to this church. You have value to Pastor Stan. You have value to the team here. You have value to whatever campus you're at. You have value because of who made you. And if you don't know who made you, Paul says, just look at the universe. See, God made you with a purpose. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And we live in a world and a society that likes to think of things as like a big cosmic accident, but one of the different things about Christianity as a faith tradition says, no, God was actually before all of it. He transcends all of it, and he actually wants it to be here. That means your story was written at the beginning of eternity, and I know that's a contradiction because eternity can't have a beginning, but it does when you're God. And at the beginning of eternity, God said, you're going to show up one day because I made you. And if we believe in the truth of science, this is matter can neither be created nor destroyed, that means that there has been a journey of you from the very beginning, and now you're here, and you're like, the universe points to me. And you're like, oh boy, that's tough. Because, I mean, you know, this is the culmination of billions of years of whatever. No. What I'm saying is God made you on purpose. And if God made you on purpose, that means you have a purpose. That means you belong here. A good friend of mine, a young man that I used to spend a lot of time with in mentoring, I'll never forget the day when we were sitting in my office at the church and we were talking and he started to tell me his story. And he really struggled with the fact because, you see, he was the result of essentially what was a one-night drunken hookup in the bathroom of a bar. And that's how he came into being. His mom and dad had no relationship. They didn't even have love. He had nothing. There was probably even issues of, did either one of them even know what was going on? And now here he is. And I had to look at him and say, no, you got to understand. Life itself is totally against the odds of it ever happening. You are here because God wanted you here. We are here on purpose. And if we're here on purpose, we're here for a purpose. So we're made with purpose, but we're also made with power. The 33rd Psalm in verse 6 says, by the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their hosts. See, God didn't need us. He wanted us. He didn't have to make us. He wasn't like, oh man, this universe is really big. I'm going to need some people to help clean it up. Like, I'm going to need to bring on some interns or something like that. Like, what should I make? No, he said, I want relationship. So think about that. I want you to think about that. God doesn't need you. God wants you. God chooses you every day and literally twice on Sundays. Every day you've existed, God has wanted to have a relationship with you. Because he didn't have to make you. You didn't have to be here, but you are. And the fact that you exist means that you matter. And the fact that you matter means you have value. He made it with purpose, he made it with power, and he made it with precision. The universe points to an ordered God. Psalm 139, verse 14 says, I praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. Some of you, you say, I don't know if I believe all this Bible stuff. I don't know. What about science? What about evolution? What about Big Bang? What about all that kind of stuff? Well, then don't listen to me. Listen to Stephen Hawking. I love science. I love physics. I love astrophysics, big physics. I love quantum physics, tiny physics. Like, I love all of it. And the reason I do is because I follow what Stephen Hawking says, where he says, the laws of science, as we know them at present, contain many fundamental numbers, perhaps like the size of the electric charge of the electron or the ratio, the masses of the proton in the electron. Don't worry, you'll wake back up. It's okay. The remarkable fact is that the values of these numbers seem to have been finally adjusted to make possible the development of life. You, quite simply, statistically, should not exist. And yet here you are, and the whole universe has been fine-tuned to bring you here. So even if you won't believe the Bible says that you matter, the fact that you are here to even ask, do I matter, means that you do. The philosopher Voltaire said, I think, therefore I am. You're asking questions, and because you're asking questions, you're being drawn to the one who can answer them. The questions that you ask, the injustice that you feel, the wrongness that you sense, it is drawing you, it is drawing you, it is drawing you to God, because he made it with purpose, he made it with power, he made it with precision, and then he made it with a point. He made it with a point because the design of all reality points us to God. Look at what Paul says. He says, ever since the creation of the world, he has been clearly perceived in the things that have been made. William Shakespeare wrote in Hamlet, he said, there are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. The universe has been calling you since day one, saying, look, your ancestors, my ancestors, all the way back to the first people that crossed the hill, all the way back to whatever weird Welsh pagan people painted blue running around, like they've all looked up at the sky for me, and they've said, what's on the other side of that? And they've been called. And what happens is we do that. We see things every day in the natural world that make us happy, right? Some of you, if you get up in the morning, you stretch, you look out there, and then boom, you see that glorious mountain. You're like, ah, man, that makes me feel good. I love that mountain. Or you go out and you're like, oh, man, that's a really good hamburger. Jesus loves me. Right? Or you hear a great song or something transcends, something lifts you up. And what God is saying is he's saying, don't stop there. Paul warns us in verse 21. He says, they knew God, but they didn't glorify him as God or give thanks to him. And it jumps down to 22. Though they claimed to be wise, they became fool. And then in verse 25, they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served created things rather than the creator. See, we stop. We stop and we think that that great cup of coffee is enough. We think that that money's going to be enough. We think that that relationship's going to be enough. It's making me happy-ish. It's making me happy enough. We say, oh, I don't need to go to church, although you're here this morning. We say, I don't need to be a part of church. I'll just go up to the mountain and camp and be connected. I just go, you know, I'll just go get on the river and go float. Like, I'll just go have a great cup of coffee. Like, we say, but Paul says, don't stop there. Don't stop there. There is a creator on the other side of all these created things. Say, how do I know that's true? I know it's true, so I have a question for you. I have a question for you, and it's going to get a little weird. But remember, it's only weird if you make it weird. So let's lean into it and we'll get this through this together. So my question is very simple. Do you like jazz? See, I love jazz. I love jazz music. And the song you're listening to right now is my favorite jazz song. It's called Take Five by Dave Brubeck. I love this song so much. The day I got married, I listened to it for like 3 hours nonstop on my CD player, which is a very old sentence. And I listened to it because I love it, because it's kind of quirky. If you pay attention, if you know anything about music, it's not in four, it's in five. So it's light, it's hip, it's quirky, it's naturally a little funky, much like myself. I love this song. But as much as I love this song, I can never ask Dave. I would love to sit down with Dave Brubeck and talk about it. Dave, tell me about that song. Why'd you write it? It was the 60s. You're doing stuff nobody's doing. This is amazing. What can I do? But I can't. Dave Brubeck's dead. Sorry to put a downer. I want to talk to the one who made it, but I can't. He's dead. It's my favorite Christian book. My favorite Christian book by my favorite Christian author, C.S. Lewis, Mere Christianity. I love this book. This book changed my life. This book brought me home to God. And I would love to sit down with C.S. Lewis and tell me, what was it like? You're writing in the war. Your story of conversion is amazing. What did you go up against? How did you get there? Like, C.S. Lewis, you changed my life. But I can't, because Lewis is dead. My favorite story, big epic story, is Lord of the Rings. Are you picking up a theme? In case you're wondering, this guy's kind of nerdy. He can't be that cool. You're right. I totally am. But I love this because it's big, it's epic, and it's wild, and I would love to sit down with Tolkien and say, tell me some things. I need to understand, what's the deal with Tom Bombadil? Why didn't you just use the eagles? But I can't. Tolkien's dead. My favorite painting by Vincent van Gogh, Starry Night. He captures the harmony and the beauty. The Song of the Spheres is what it was called. He gets the energy that exists in the universe. How did you see that? How did you know that? I would love to talk to him. I'd say, no, you need to give me your other ear. You gotta hear me. But I can't, because he's dead. My favorite movies, Star Wars. I'd love to talk to George Lucas, but I can't, because he's dead to me. George, how'd you think of this? A cowboy movie in space? Like, what is that? Who really shot first? I'll never get to meet George Lucas. But I love these things, and I'm intrigued by the ones who created them. I want to show you another picture. This is my favorite place on the planet. This is Tyler Bend. It's on the White River in Arkansas, or in the Buffalo River, excuse me, in Arkansas. I love this place. It's in a little town called Gilbert, Arkansas, population 45. That's like on game day. That's like when everyone comes, right? But so many times in my life, I've driven to these shores and I've reached out to God. This is what the previous generation of my faith tradition, the Pentecostals, called God's great tabernacle in the wild. That's my temple. And I hear from God there, and I've talked to God there, and I love that place. It's deep to me. That's my favorite place on the earth. And these are my favorite people. So you have my wife, my wife's in the middle. That's my daughter, Sophie, my son, Max, and our littlest one, Avery. These are my favorite people. I love them. And here's the difference between Lord of the Rings and Star Wars and Mere Christianity and Take Five and Starry Night, all those kinds of things. I can never talk to the one that made them. But here's the thing. I can talk every day to the one that made Tyler Bend, Arkansas. And I can talk every day to the one that made those four people on that screen. And I can say, you are showing me things through them that I believe should be pointing me to you. Because as much as my wife loves me, and trust me, she has to love me unconditionally. I mean, let's be honest. I outkicked my coverage on that one, right? But she's taught me what unconditional love is. She's taught me what grace is. But she didn't teach me so that I could worship her. God used her so that I would find him. My kids have taught me, what would you be willing to do for your children? What would you be willing to sacrifice for your children? And in that lesson, I learned what parental love and sacrifice looks like. But I don't do that so that I can put them on a pedestal. I do that because God uses their love to point me to him. You see, you have things in your life that you love. You have people in your life that you love. You have places in your life that you love. And the reason those things matter are not because they're great, but because God is saying, this is what love looks like. Because it says in Romans that from the beginning, his divine attributes, his invisible nature has been clearly seen in everything you experience. And whether it's Mount Adams or Stumptown Coffee or great music or your loved ones or a friend, it's all saying God is love. And if you can comprehend what it is to love something, you can begin to comprehend that Jesus loves you. See, I get called a theologian. I'm the teaching and theology pastor. I will give you the single most profound theological truth I can ever share with you is this: Jesus loves you. And I'll make it even better. Jesus loves you. Yes, you. Even you. And that God has built the universe so that you can find him. So that you can say, God, what is this? Who am I? Do I matter? And the answer is yes. How do I know that I matter? How do you know you matter? Simple. Because there's a Mount Adams that would point you to God. Because there's Stumptown Coffee that would point you to God. I love Cracker Barrel. Because there's Cracker Barrel. Because there's your family. Because there's your loved one. Because there's that moment where you feel like there's something else, where your soul is saying, surely there's greater something in heaven and earth. And on the other side of that is the Spirit of God pulling you up and saying, come up here, I love you. Don't let those things be enough, but push through because you matter. You matter because God made you. You matter because you exist. You matter and you are loved. This church, this community wants you to know you are loved. God wants you to know you are loved. Everybody is somebody, and Jesus is all. That's not just a clever slogan. That is a fundamental truth where God says through Paul, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it's the power of God to save everyone. And if you are wondering, am I everyone? It's kind of in the meaning of the word. Yes, you count as everyone. In Romans 10, he'd say it later. He'd say, anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So I want to encourage you, whatever it is you've been feeling, whatever it is you've been experiencing, whatever doubt, whatever fear, whatever questions, follow through. Find them. Push through those things. Say, God, show me. God, reveal to me. God, speak to me. God, let me know. Because you matter to God. You matter to us, you matter to Pastor Stan, you matter to this team, and we all want to hang out with you forever. Would you bow your heads with me this morning?